Thank you, and thank you to ACBC and to Roxby for this opportunity to come and talk to you a little bit about some of the research that's done in the Faculty of Science at the University of Technology, Sydney. Let's hope it all works. We have a number of research strengths, and it's obviously this is going to be a fairly different talk because I'm going to talk more about the sort of research capabilities that are available in Australia and certainly and at UTS specifically. And in the area of energy, and clean energy, of course, it's obviously very topical for some of the potential collaborations that might come out of a meeting such as this. Our areas are around technologies and materials for clean energy. And as you can see, we work in a wide variety of areas, energy storage materials, lighting, both actual lights and also the physics of lighting, which is quite interesting. The modelling that underpins that, the physics that underpins that in the plasmonics, and also some very interesting manufacturing techniques. So we actually develop the techniques that are then able to be translated into new businesses. Around energy storage and energy storage materials, this is largely Professor Wong's area, we've got a number of different research sub-programs, I should really say, around battery technologies. And these are then going or designed for use quite often in automobiles, but also very high supercapacitor technologies used for buffering energy, and fuel cell technologies, both hydrogen and biofuels, and then on through the powertrain that goes into electric vehicles. Find that. So in terms of electrification, so EVs are electric vehicles, HEVs are hybrid electric vehicles, and PHEVs, for some reason, are plug-in hybrid electric vehicles. So that's why, unfortunately, the acronyms go there rather than the full things. They occupy too much space. But basically, behind them, you need very high capacity, very light batteries, and the current technologies that we're working on are around lithium batteries, and also special materials. There's the lithium, nickel, manganese, and cobalt oxide cathode materials, so they provide the actual collecting plates for the electricity, and other sorts of lithium-based materials, which sort of sit within a lithium battery, allows you to, with the right sorts of technologies, go through more charge-discharge cycles. One of the big problems currently with rechargeable batteries, people who have rechargeable ones know that after a while they wear out, a few thousand, if you're lucky, charge cycles, and you wear out. When you've got expensive batteries in cars, you need to have more and more charge-recharge cycles to make it worthwhile doing, and this is some of the research we're doing on that area. And we have some of the world's best equipment for developing new batteries and testing them, and that's shown in the slide there. Also, with the battery technology, there's more about what happens in basically the sort of national power grid system. You have baseload power plants that like to produce the same amount of power all the time. You have more renewable energy power plants, the solar power plants and the wind energy power plants, that produce power at different times of day, solar ones during the daytime only, wind turbines whenever the wind's working. That's not necessarily when the power's needed. And so you need this sort of high, very, very high capacity battery storage to be able to buffer the generating times and the generating amounts against the load. And so part of our battery technology is also working on how to develop those really high capacity battery storage systems. If we go on to the material side, from the technology side, for a little while, we're working on light emitting diode systems so we can replace neon lights and these incandescent lights and those sorts of things with high efficiency materials that produce a lot more light for the amount of energy that you use, and developing the different materials that produce their light at different colours so that we can actually get back to something that is more like warm sunlight. And why would you want to do this? Because if you go from incandescent bulbs, which are around 15 lumens per watt, to LED lights, which give you 150 lumens per watt, you get tenfold improvement of your energy efficiency here. You can reduce global energy usage by a very substantial amount, and that produces very big savings, both in terms of the money you spend on electricity, but also the amount of CO2 that's likely to be thrown into the atmosphere. 190 megatons of CO2 could be reduced by switching from incandescent to high-efficiency LEDs. Now, they're not the only things that you can do better, because we put a lot of light on there, and you can see all the lights on in here, even though we've got windows, floor-to-ceiling windows on one side, and it's not a particularly wide room. Why? Because we put ourselves inside, we like to live in caves, but we're missing out on the opportunity of collecting a lot of sunlight. We actually, at UTS, have developed some much more efficient ways of collecting sunlight and running light pipes, and so that the sunlight actually can be channeled down to where you want to get there. And be able to do that and bring in light without actually bringing in the heat that's associated with the light. So our lighting physics is around giving you light without the heat. Back to a bit of technology. We have electron beam technologies where we can actually physically generate very, very precisely defined shapes, and then having done the etching side, we can then go on to actually use the same technology to build new shapes, new devices in situ. This is actually sitting in the middle of an electron microscope. It's a fairly expensive way of manufacturing at the moment, but it's a proof of principle technology, and we have some of the world's best physicists and chemists involved in working on these technologies, which once we've done that, once we've actually developed the technology, we can then export. And of course, some part of this goes to collaborations elsewhere, and including using these sorts of technologies to look at and identify what's actually happening in a number of interesting applications, including obviously the NASA Stardust mission. So we're involved with a number of very important international collaborations. This is just a quick list of the major players in the area. So we have Matt Phillips and Quan Toc Tat, who work in solid-state lighting. Prof Wang, as I said, works on the battery technologies. Andrew McDonough and Matt Phillips in photovoltaics. Matt Arnold and his group in plasmonics. Jeff Smith, who's in the daylighting physics, done a lot of work in there, and Mike Ford and Matt Arnold in the computational modelling areas. And just as an acknowledgement for all of the groups, UTS is very committed to being able to take the sorts of technologies that we're developing in the clean energy area to whomever we would be interested. We've in discussions with a number of universities in China with this, but obviously we'd be very happy also to be involved with both Australian and Chinese industry, the SMEs, in taking up this sort of technology and promoting it worldwide. Thank you.